Good evening, this is Kuro. Got a tier 7 game in my Jervis going over the matchmaking. We've got an enemy ranger. No radar this match. It only being tier 7. Other threats to my ship Miyoko and Grizia, or however you pronounce it. They can pack a wall up if they catch you. Destroyer threats Mayhan, which is a menace with its current buffs and situations that it's got with its gun DPM with 5 turrets. Mayhan is it's a really solid tier 7 destroyer right now. Vauquelin, or the tier 7 French destroyer, like all the other French DDs, you know, that thing can lay a hurt on you quickly. And then the last two enemy DDs, we got 2 war canoes, the Ohotniks, in a division. Thing to consider about them is the alpha strike that they have on them. The guns, they've got a lot of gun turrets, and both of them working together, they've got really good concealment, and they can really just slap a destroyer down if the guys know how to aim correctly. The other thing you have to worry about is the torpedo spam, because they have practically all the torpedoes in the world. So right here, I'm going to pause it because a tale of two CVs. Right now, one of the first things I'm doing when I come into a battle and I'm going towards a cap, I'm looking at, you know, not only my position, my team's position, but in a CV match, I'm looking to see, you know, how good's my CV? How good is the enemy CV? And that will give me some information about how to approach it later on. I don't know either of these CV players off the top of my head, so it's an unknown quantity. So I'm approaching it just from the standpoint of, let's look and see what these guys do. And right out of the bat, I see that my CV, he hasn't dropped a fighter to cover any likely areas where his DDs are going to want to work. The enemy's CV has. So right off the bat, I'm kind of thinking that the enemy CV is going to be more situationally aware with, you know, the game and being able to support his team than my CV is. The good thing that my CV has done is he's pushed ahead. He has managed to spot one of the DDs, the Ohotnik, which tells me that we likely have 2 Ohotniks. Now, just like usual, stay concealed till the last minute. I get plane spotted. Then, since he's not striking me, I'm just instantly focusing my AA on the planes. And I am going to, since that squad's done, we've got a Atlanta behind us. We do have a radar advantage on the cap. That's why I'm pushing this so aggressive. Popping hydro early. I know these things have all the torpedoes you could ever want. So just going to push out here and smoke up, because my Atlanta, if you noticed in the chat, has popped radar. And I am just going to take advantage of this situation and start working on the Ohotniks. Now you can start to see some of the torpedoes coming in. This is why I popped hydro early. I'm able to pick up the kill on one of them, but I'm kind of forced in behind the island with all the torpedo spam coming my way. But now that the torpedoes are giving me a channel to work with, gonna push back out. This Ohotnik, he's dead man walking. This is not how you play a destroyer. I'm able to pick up the kill there, and enemy CV still in the area. They did lay this smoke screen for me, so I'm just gonna push up into this smoke screen and try to use this to keep me from being reset by one of these cruisers, the Miyoko and the Kirov. I'm not worried really about the torpedoes from the CV. more worried about, you know, being spotted and the cruiser is resetting me.
Torpedoes astern.
So, unfortunately, the smoke screen's wearing out. I do just pop my own. Now, to note about this captain, this isn't one of my 19-point ringers that you see in a lot of my other games. Had some people saying that they were struggling with the ship, so I had a 13-point captain laying around. I threw on the ship so you could kind of see what this ship looks like with kind of a realistic captain when you're initially grinding it. So I'll link the build description below. Well, basically, it's a concealment build, obviously, with basic firing training and survivability expert being my two perks, my two 3-point perks to give me 13. Now, this is how you're going to need to utilize your torpedoes up through lightning. A lot of it is, you know, island ambushes, waiting for ships to push into you. And, you know, I'm kind of taking a gamble here, sitting here with the HE dive bombers coming in. But nobody can really shoot at me. But now that, you know, those dive bombers are going to come back, I'm just going to go ahead and smoke up. And I was waiting for the Gneisenau now to see if he was going to poke around the island. And since it's obvious he beached running aground, I'm just gonna get out of here. There's nothing really for me here. What's going to happen? And this is actually a trap. Take a look at the situation on the map. And this, I'll use this to segue into a conversation that I've seen a lot of people having in the game, and that is stomps. Just absolute games are over, ridiculously fast. Nobody has time to really get out and put in work and get good rewards just because the enemy team just falls apart, or one of the teams just falls apart so quickly. And as you know, a decent player that plays solo, you know, it's one of those things that does hurt my win rate because just playing solo, because it's really difficult to carry games consistently when, you know, you're 5 minutes, I mean, we're not even 6 minutes in, and the enemy team has 5 ships down. They're already have lost almost half their team. That's really rough to come back from. So what I'm doing here is I've already started switching from, you know, trying to win the game. The game is pretty much won right now. We're up 2 ships. We've got a cap. They don't even have a cap. And, you know, the position, you know, and more importantly, really kind of tails the tape here. We've got the Helena and the French destroyer squaring off here. This could go either way. If the Vauquelin lands torps on the Helena, although I think most likely the Helena's probably got hydro up, or at least I would hope he would. And the Helena's got a lot of guns to really just eviscerate destroyers at these sorts of ranges. So this one could go either way. There is a King George down here that, I mean, this ship with HE is disgusting on destroyer. So I think this DD is probably in a pickle. But I mean, beyond that, you take a look at the flank here. And I mean, they're just in complete disarray. My team's pushing through. And how this map is sort of plays frequently is, you know, teams will take one of the flanks and then they'll push through into B cap. And once you can actually get into B cap and into the islands on the opposing side, you kind of wall off the center of the map. And you're going to see how I'm going to snake right around these islands, just shooting and everything as I go. And it just makes it, exceedingly difficult for an enemy ship to actually push through one of these choke points when you have a ship, particularly a destroyer in this case, that can just knock the hell out of something with torpedoes. So I know there's a full health Nelson coming. At the end of the day, I don't care. The Nelson, yes, it's got a good chunk of HP, but at the end of the day, since I'm looking for, the most rewards, look at where most of these ships are headed. The Miyoko's bugging out, the Kirov, Ganaizenau, they're all bugging out. This is the only guy that hasn't really figured out what's going on. And Nelson, in particular, is not a very well-armored battleship. It tends to lose a lot of HP quickly, particularly when it's giving a lot of broadside. So, just one of those things. Not gonna try to follow the Nelson to try to get my damage. Maybe that's, a smart play. Maybe it's not. But I am gonna push up here, right around these islands. I'm gonna try to work on this Kirov. One of the other things, prioritizing damage. Damage to a cruiser is a lot more valuable than damage done to a battleship. As far as at least your gun alpha, you've got the fire chant or fires tick percentage wise, so it kind of evens that out. But not to mention, Kirov is a lot more softly armored than a Gneisenau when it comes to my HE penning it. So everything's still moving. I know I'm gonna get struck by dive bombers. At this point, I don't really care as much about my hit points. It's more about getting damage out, staying in a position where I can do damage. So I'm chasing this Gneisenau, this Kirov, and in the meantime, I'm gonna work on this Miyoko. And if the CV hits me, the CV hits me. I mean, if I was still trying to play this, safe, I would still be in my smoke. Wait till the enemy CV, goes elsewhere. But if I was doing that, I wouldn't be in position to keep chasing these guys. And that's going to have a pretty good impact on the rest of my battle. Trying to make sure I don't get team killed here. Now I should smoke right here. I am late here. I should smoke up, too focused on getting damage out. I shouldn't have had taken that drop. And if I would have gotten that smoke off earlier, I wouldn't have taken that damage there. So I hit a, kind of the max level of hit points that I'm really willing to give away right now. Just was sloppy there, and it cost me more hit points than what I was intending. But since the game is still well in hand, just still gonna keep playing aggressive, to keep chasing this Gneisenau. And the situation is, this Gneisenau, he's me chasing him. I'm in effect walling him off from all of these caps, and he's forced into the situation. He's either gonna have to push in here, or he's gonna just have to, decide I'm just gonna have a crap game, and that's that. And this Gneisenau does make the decision that he is gonna push in here. And I'm looking at him now. I'm gonna talk about these torpedoes because I've chased this guy, more than halfway across the map. His indicator is telling me he's going full speed. And what I'm looking at is, You know, this guy's had a DD on his heels pretty much most of the game. So, I'm gonna launch one set of torps almost at the indicator. It's ever so slightly behind. And then I'm gonna launch one way short. And what I'm doing is I'm trying to account for this guy when he comes around the island, just slamming on the brakes to try to juke any sort of torpedoes coming through here. That was, you know, my thoughts behind this. But I almost get outplayed here because he just straight lines it. Now, you notice again using the islands for concealment. This is, if you played this game a long time ago, this is, you know, old US destroyer tactics up until, you know, Mahan, really, I think. But it works on Royal Navy destroyers, and it's, I really do like playing around torpedoes with this sort of play style. So I do end up picking up two torpedo hits. If I would have actually led at the indicator, I might have been able to pick up a third. But you know, stuff happens. So just gonna try to finish this Gneisenau now. He's in a bad place right now. This is sort of where having demolition expert would really be nice for that extra fire chance, but enemy team picks up that kill. And I'm going to push up here and try to go after this Miyoko. So, kind of the one of the things to note about this game is I really wouldn't have been in a position to get those torps off on the Gneisenau. I wouldn't be able to get in position to pick up the kill on the Miyoko if I hadn't been aggressive and just kept pushing. Even though the CV was going to hit me, I was still able to try to manage my HP. This isn't a barn burner of a game, but it's a really solid result in a ship that, I mean, you know, almost 80K with a tier 7 destroyer, it's gonna give you know, super unicum stats, particularly with 3 kills. And that it's a pretty solid performance. But the lesson right here is, you know, understanding that teams are gonna start folding really early, and you've got the snowball effect. Something goes wrong on the enemy team, and it's, you know, that little creates a little snowball, and then something else happens, and that snowball just keeps getting bigger and bigger, and then it all of a sudden it's just like roars right through the enemy team, and it's over. And if you're not, you know, really looking at your map awareness, what's going on with, you know, the entire battle, if you miss that snowball being formed, it puts you behind the curve on being able to get out there and really try to maximize your damage potential. So I'm gonna go ahead and cut this one off here. I hope you guys enjoyed this game. Didn't talk too much about Jervis play style, but it's a Royal Navy destroyer. It's you know, it's a gunboat. You've got, you know, predominantly defensive torpedoes up until sort of the Lightning, where you've got a little bit longer range torpedoes. Jutland and Daring, you pick up longer range torpedoes yet, and you're really able to at that point start starting to torp more like a regular torpedo boat, but I still consider both of those destroyers full gunboats. Just because how spectacular the gun and smoke combo is. It's just ridiculously strong right now. So anyway, if you guys have any questions or comments, leave them below. I hope you're having a good night, and I will talk to you later.